Oh, praise the Lord. Let's just stand as we look to the Lord this morning. Prayer requests. I know Brother Bob's son and your brother.
For Evelyn.
As well as sick. So we definitely need Sister York as well. Yeah, that's right. All right, let's all lift up our voice together. Heavenly Father, as we come before thy throne of grace. And Lord, we're thankful that we can approach through that blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, you've seen all the requests that has brought before thee this morning. I pray, Lord, that you extend thy hand, not only heal and touch their body, but Lord, lift them up in spirit as well. Lord, we think of those that may be hooked up by the internet, Lord. There's no distance with thee. And Lord, we remember thy nation Israel. Lord, that you be with them. Now we ask that in that precious name that's above every name, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Can you see it this morning? I just caught in between there.
Does anybody know what number power in the blood? Number 10, of course. Thank you. Praise the Lord.
Be the glory, take things He has done. Thank you.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Right under a bushel, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Looking at me, you see mercy. When you're looking at me, you see grace. When you're looking at me, you see saved. For I've been saved by His mercy and grace. When you're looking at me, you see mercy. When you're looking at me, you see grace.
Not as
as I am. Use me in garments as white as snow. For the Lamb of God is worthy, and He washed me this day. And when He sees me, He sees the blood. Pilgrim on a journey, headed for a better land. The way is rough and trials so hard to understand. I call the one who started with me, said he'd be there till the end. And when I need strength, this is me again. And it's so hard to comprehend. He takes the heart of me. The stars, they shine. The sun rises on His command. I'm just a small, small grain of sand in the wonders of His hand. And now, listen to me, He blesses me again. I've not always been the best man for the Lord that I could be. I stumble, yes, and sometimes I've given in. But the Lord is great in mercy. In the moment I repent, I find blessing me. He blesses me again.
shine, the sun rises on his command. I'm just a small, small grain of sand in the wonders of his hands. He blesses me, he blesses me again.
Sister Monique, would you have a song this morning?
have is wonderful. Let go and let God have His way. Your sorrows will vanish. Your night turn to day. Let go.
God have His way. Joyce, do you have a song this morning? No. Elijah? Mike, do you have a song afterwards?
Oh, many or not, the Lord is coming. Oh, many or not, He's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, many or not, He's coming again. The world says He's not coming. And everybody, there's no end. But it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, whether or not, He's coming again. Oh, whether or not, the Lord is coming. Oh, whether or not, He's coming again. Says, oh, where you're not, He's coming again. Oh, will the bridegroom, oh, find you waiting? Oh, will your eye be shining for Him? Oh, when the call comes, go out to meet Him. Oh, where you're not, He's coming again. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, He's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. He's coming again. Well, two in the bend and one will be taken. Oh, two in the field and one will stay. Oh, when the call comes, go out to meet him. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Well, they're going to wash to the walls and the mountains and cry for the walls to fall on them. But they can't find his great judgment. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Oh, will the bridegroom, oh, find you waiting? Oh, will your eye be shining for him? Oh, when the call comes, go out to meet him. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Well, two in the bend, and one will be taken. Oh, two in the field, and one will stay. Oh, when the call comes, go out to meet him. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again, amen. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. Oh, where you're not, the Lord is coming. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again. And it don't matter, oh, what the world says. Oh, where you're not, he's coming again.
People said I'd never make it. I'd never see it through. They don't know what keeps me going, 'cause they never have met you. All my life was a shambles, till the day you came along and turned my tears into laughter. You gave me a brand new song. I'm still holding on. Lord, I'll never let you go. You gave me a smile, touched my heart, touched my soul. All the bridges left behind me, Lord, I burn them to the ground. I'm still holding on. You're the best friend I ever found. Voted likely not to prosper with that hanging over my head. He'll never amount to nothing. That's what most people say. Been known to be unsettled, never stayed around too long. You're the treasure I've been searching for. I'm still holding on. I'm still holding on. Lord, I'll never let you go. You gave me a smile, you touched my heart, touch my soul. All the bridges left behind me, Lord, I burn them to the ground. I'm still holding on. You're the best friend I ever found. Yes, I'm still holding on. Lord, I'll never let you go. You gave me a smile, touched my heart, touch my soul. All the bridges left behind me, Lord, I burn them to the ground. I'm still holding on. You're the best friend I ever found.
I just want a little testimony. I'm thankful today for my wife. And I'm just going to say, she's just as beautiful on the inside as she is on the outside. And
She's helped me a lot, and I hope I've helped her too. God's really blessed us.
Is it Lauren? Brittany, do you have a song? You sure? Do you want to come up and sing one with me, maybe? Yeah, she. No? Okay. Do you want to try the one we did in St. John the other day? No pressure.
In your time, in your time, you make all things beautiful. In your time, you make all things beautiful.
Till one day I heard footsteps down the hall of that dungeon, and a voice cried, I've come to redeem the best thing I've ever heard. I've been brought here from there by that precious word. I'm free, I'm forgiven, I'm washed and I'm clean. Jesus bought me, thank God I'm redeemed. Redeemed, the best thing I've ever heard. I've been brought here from there by that precious word. I'm free, I'm forgiven, I'm washed and I'm clean. Jesus bought me, thank God I'm redeemed. And oh, how Christ loved us so much that he bled. He died on that old rugged tree. His blood was my payment. Now I'm freed forever. I'm his now. Thank God I'm redeemed. Redeemed, the best thing I've ever heard. I've been brought here from there by that precious word. I'm free, I'm forgiven, I'm washed and I'm clean. Jesus bought me. Thank God I'm redeemed. Redeemed, the best thing I've ever heard. I've been brought here from there by that precious word. I'm free, I'm forgiven, I'm washed and I'm clean. Jesus bought me. Thank God I'm
thankful this morning for the Lord's presence. Past Friday, I was trying to get a lot of things done, and went out and purchased a new set of tires for Jeremy's truck, and a fella in Dorchester that had them. And however, I was having a small talk with him, and I was buying the tires. He said, "You, how would you like to come in and have a piece of chocolate cake with boiled frosting icing? That sounds really good." And I walked into the house, and his wife came out and wanted to know if I wanted a cup of coffee. I thought, yeah, that'd be really nice. And just turned out that they were a Jehovah Witness couple, and I'm just thankful that for that kindle spirit. It's just you don't show up in anybody's yard being a total stranger and they invite you in for chocolate cake and coffee. But my thoughts just drifted away of being in a rush and getting things done. It was just a nice little visit and talked of different things and their family and kids. And it just reminded me, though, that we are 8 different people when God enters and abides within. He changes changes things. It does make us a little different. I'm just thankful this morning. In the beginning, He was a creator. Into existence, He spoke the heavenly blue. And the night, He swooped up His hand. He threw out the stars, and He knew where they land. So if you think you're drifting along, well, I have good news. If He hung the moon, I know He will help you. He holds the sparrows and fly. He holds you too. Consider the lilies in the field, how much more He loves you. In the beginning of time, a year on His mind, when He hung moon. When you feel like the world is hard on your shoulder, and even your closest friend in life is pulling away, though you have tried so hard and lost, there is still hope. Just look to the cross, and there you will see just how much the Savior still loves you today. If He hung the moon, I know He will help you. And if He holds the sparrows and flies, well, He holds you too. Consider the lilies in the field, how much more He loves you. In the beginning of time, a year on His mind, when He hung the moon. If He hung the moon, I know He will help you. And if He holds the sparrows and flies, well, He holds you too. Consider the lilies in the field, how much more He loves you. In the beginning of time, a year on His mind, when He hung the moon. And if He hung the moon, I know He will help you. And if He holds the sparrows and flies, He holds you too. Consider the lilies in the field, how much more He loves you. In the beginning of time, a year on His mind, when He hung the moon.
Anybody else have anything on their hearts this morning? We turn the service over. That is good.
Let's just stand at this time. I forgot about Sister Wenda. She's in the hospital, Ray. That's why Ray is there this morning, so be there all day. Heavenly Father, as we come before Thee, we thank the Lord that we have a place that we can come and fellowship together. Now, Lord, as we look into your word, I just pray, Lord, you would have your way, for I ask it now in that precious name, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Be seated this morning. I'm going to be looking in Genesis, the first chapter. And verse 14. But before I get into the message, this world's getting worse and worse. You don't need to be a rocket scientist to understand that part. But I thought I'd list a few things that I know there's been instability in the world, but we're moving to a place in time that seems like things that are happening in the Middle East and Europe is far away from here. And so Russia, Putin has been more brazen in the last while, and there's a reason for it. Russia has developed a new nuclear missile. They had before what's called the SS-20s. They could reach America, but by the time you reach America, you'd have half hour, not at least an hour before it comes, so you'd have time to react to it. But now they developed this new missile, and they call it the Satan II, of all things. And apparently this missile flies over 4,000 miles an hour. And there's no defense against it. It's flying so fast, and it's also stealthy as well. It can reach London in 13 minutes. Flying over the pole, it could reach the United States in 12. Now can you imagine that by the time decisions are made, that's pretty well on its way, isn't it? Not only that it is stealthy, that NATO doesn't seem to have anything, or the United States doesn't seem to have anything to knock it down, because the older missiles would travel, I don't know, maybe 2,000 and a half miles per hour, and they had systems to knock those things down as they would come up over the pole or wherever the case may be. But now with this new type of missile, the thing is it carries multiple warheads on it. Just one of those missiles carries 16 warheads. And it can destroy the whole country of France or the whole state of Texas in one shot. Now that's, I don't mean to say things to scare you, but it's just showing the instability. And that's why he's been brazen. That's where NATO tried to do things. Now, we got Trump in that will be in the office, so we don't know how things will work out there. And at the same time, Israel has been building up some of her strategic things to defend herself too. Although Israel is building up some of her armament, it's not her armament that's going to save her in the miracle war. It'll be the Lord intervening on the scene. I don't care what kind of missile or what kind of weaponry they have. It won't touch an angel. And it won't touch God either. So Israel has now gotten their fifth, and they're looking for their sixth submarine. They're not nuclear-powered. But the reason they went with the German submarine, they're quieter even than a nuclear submarine. And so they can set them off of Iran or any country that would seem to pose a problem. And so it's a deterrent that Israel, that someone would try to make a first strike on Israel, they are doomed to be devastated as well. That's what happened in the Cold War in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, how that back then, it would be foolish for one country to go to war with nuclear weapons because it's self-destruction on your part as well. And so that's the world we're living in. Pressures are mounting. Nations are being pressured in doing different things. Even in the economics, there's been a shaking since the beginning of this year. And when I looked at the shaking, when it came at the beginning of 2016, the Lord impressed on a message concerning there's no place to hide. And that's not for the religious world, it's not for the world, but the message in this hour. If God's using a vessel to speak a revelation on ground, it'll do one or two things. Either the children of God will see it and walk with it, or try to push away from it and say, no, we don't believe that. We don't accept that. And so this causes shaking in the movement. There's a shaking in the political world. We've seen that, what has happened in the United States, and it's not finished shaking yet. And so God is actually putting the pressure on, because if we're living in time that where God is going to move on behalf of Israel, he's going to move on behalf of the bride of Jesus Christ. And so therefore, that's the hour we live in. But this morning, I felt to take a message concerning knowing the time we're living in. Recognizing the time. And to recognize the time, it's not because you can read it in the newspaper or you can Google it and find things in that manner. We have to look at it in the terms of God's Word, how time is portrayed, how God expresses time. And to go to the foundation of this, of times, let's go to Genesis now, the first chapter, verse 14. And this is in the creative days. In the world, by the time God wanted, before he placed man on it, God had brought the planet to a halt. He put it into a deep freeze and stopped the prehistoric world. That was about 22,000 years ago. Around about. I mean, if some say 2,500 years. I'm not going to argue with that. Nobody was there to show it. So from the best estimate they have, 22,000 years ago, the earth was in a deep freeze, and God had put a halt to the planet. When we look in Genesis, all God had, and to put the earth in a deep freeze, all God had to do is move the planet away from the sun, and it would cool and freeze. But then, going back now about 14,000 years ago, rather than 22, all God was doing in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, he gently moves the planet towards a closer orbit towards the sun. Now, Moses did not have a geological background or of nature, in the sense of nature of knowing what's happening with the planet like we do today. So God had to speak to Moses that wrote the book. God told him to write it this way so that he could understand and at least get a glimpse But God didn't tell them, I'm going to move the planet, and these are the cause and effect that's going to happen in those creative days. Or restoring days, I should say. So the first thing, when the planet is covered with ice, as it gets closer, God says, the earth was in darkness, void. But as it gets warmed up and the ice starts to melt, then finally light strikes the surface of the planet. So God said, let there be light. But the sun is over 5 billion years old. So it's pertaining light striking the surface of the earth. And as it gets warmer, the water melts. Then you start having vapor. You have seas. Until we reach to the fourth day. And after the ice has receded and melted, and the waters, vapor move above, and the waters below, which is the waters of the oceans, or the water that we have, start to go in their places. Then there's because as you have, and we witness this here, especially in Canada, when you have a cold day and then you get a warmer day, as the ice would start to melt, you get fog. How many knows what fog is? I don't have to explain fog, right? So as the planet gets warmer up, the fog dissipates, and then now a man would have been standing on the earth, he could look up into the sky, and now he could see the stars, the moon, all the things that are in the heavens. And this is now we're at that fourth day, and God says, let there be lights in the firmaments of the heaven. Well, it's not that he's saying, I've just put them there. Because the sun, like I said, I mentioned, is 5 billion years old. And so, as man now would look up, he can see the lights in the firmament of heaven and And the lights in the heavens actually was to divide the day from night and let them be for signs and for seasons, for days and years. So God is now using a basic pronunciation that he's giving in his word, that the lights in the heavens, whether it be the sun or the moon or the stars, are for signs, they're for seasons, for days and years. All right, is that clear enough? So that's where we would start. How God uses the term times. Now the words time, if I mention that to somebody on the street, time, you'll say, oh, what do you want to know? What time is it? No. That's one expression of it. But when we're looking at the definitions of God, and we expounded this a few weeks ago. We looked at the word day. And immediately, us Gentile, our mind goes, that's 24 hours. Well, that's here well on Earth. But if you're Mercury, it's only, 14 hours or less? Because it spins much quicker. So the day is not so much in the terms of hours in time frame that you can measure. God used something simple. And he says, from the darkness to the light and back to the darkness, it makes a complete cycle. So that's why on Earth, yes, it is 24 hours, as we know it now. But if you're on Saturn or if you're on Mercury, it is not 24 hours. But they do have a cycle of their day. All right. Then when there's the definition of, is that clear enough to understand what, because let's not forget when we're talking about a day, God's talking about a night, a day, and back to night. He returns as a cycle. Weeks is the definitions of week there too in the scriptures. And you'll find it in Genesis 29, 18 and 19, where Jacob worked for Rachel. We, today, if I ask somebody on the street, what is a week? He'll say 7 days. But a week in the biblical term doesn't mean 7 days. It only means seven of. It's a multiplier of. And God can use the word weeks to use it for days, or He can use it for years as well. I know this is basic, but we're just getting some things in here to begin with. Now, when we talk about times, we all went to school. And how many took mathematics in grade one or two? 2 times 2 is 4, right? The word times means it's a multiplier of something. And unless you look in the chapter or the phrase what it's referring to, it just means a multiplier of. All right? Now, seasons, just for now, the word seasons in the scripture really refers to in the terms of decades. It can be one day, seasons plural is more than one decade, but it's in terms of decades. So God, we're going to find out that God's going to use, in what I'm looking at this morning, He's going to use times in the terms of centuries. He's going to use seasons in the terms of decades. And He's going to talk about day, weeks and days. So those are in different aspects of perspective of how we would look at time. In the week of Daniel, and we had looked at this chart here. We know that in the week of Daniel, it's 7 years. But as you read certain scriptures, it says, well, it's 42 months. No, it's times, and a half of times. But times is a multiplier. But as you read it in that verse, in that scripture, it's not talking about centuries, it's talking about years. So, just to make an iron fast rule saying, well, times means a year, and that's all there is to it. No, it's just a multiplier. Because we know that time, times, and half of times, or 1,260 days, or 42 months, really is 3.5 years. But because we take the multiplier and we put years to the multiplier. All right? So far, so good? All right. Now, get into the message. This one here, yeah. Now I want to go to Acts chapter 1. Now, Jesus had just been talking to His disciples. He told them, stay in Jerusalem, then you'll be endued with power from on high. But in Matthew 24, they had a discourse or a conversation. They wanted to know what's on now and what's going to happen at the end. And as we're in the book of Acts, I'm sure the disciples wanted to know more about, again, what is the end? Because they want to be in heaven. They want to rule with the Lord Jesus Christ. So as we pick it up in verse 6, and when they were come together, they asked Him, saying, Lord, wilt Thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? Because they had it in their mind what He spoke to them in Matthew about wars, rumors of wars, pestilence, so forth, and everything leading up down through a period of time. They had no knowledge of what the future would be or how long that would even be. But they felt they would be in their lifetime. And so they were kind of curious to find out, when are these things going to take place? Well, Jesus knew we wouldn't be in their lifetime. So he goes on and says in verse 7, he says, and he said unto them, it's not for you to know. Oh, but Jesus, that's not nice. I want to know. Ain't that like this generation too? I want to know now, not tomorrow. It's not for you to know the times, plural, or the seasons which the Father has put in His own power. That power to know the seasons and the time was not given to Jesus at that point in time. It's the Father that has the time frame in it. Because Jesus said one day, no man knows the day or the hour, not even the Son of Man, not even Himself. He knows when that day would be. Although the Father showed Him the picture of things going in. So He wouldn't know the actual day or the hour. He couldn't say, well, in 24 or something, or whatever date you want to look at, that's when it's going to happen. So as Jesus puts it forth here, He says, it's not for you to know the time or the seasons. So they're standing right over here in 33 AD. And to know the times and the seasons, no man would know it or have an inkling of it till things on earth would materialize, or history would be recorded as going down through time, that man can now start looking towards the end. The believers in that first church age, when they got the letter from John the Apostle, and there's a message sent to the seven church ages that was in Asia Minor, they knew what it was given to the churches, but I don't believe they could see and understand that it was going to be a projection of seven different stages through the grace age that things would transpire. First of all, if the Lord had opened up and said, these are going to be the different ages and things are going to transpire in it. Remember, they have no history, no knowledge. You and I have the history. We're looking backwards towards what we know what took place. So the time of the seasons was the Father has put in His own power. Now when we're looking at the times and the seasons, times is a number of. Times is not going to be a year and so many years from 33, and you count, oh, time, 2,000 times, then you get there. No, times implies centuries. So, He could have revealed to them, He says, it's not for you to know the times or the centuries that will pass before that day that you're looking at, coming to the kingdom, ever comes into play. Is that clear enough this morning? I hope it is. I'm trying to be as clear as slow as possible. I'm not trying to go fast. So the times, in this respect, and He doesn't tell you how many times. He says the times will be centuries. And then He adds the word seasons, the decades. Now, when you come to seasons, you're no longer looking at every 100 years period of time anymore. So it would fall in this generation that we live in, that in 1948, Israel became a nation in one day. Now remember, the Jews, His disciples were asking, when are you going to restore the kingdom? Because they wanted to sit on the temples. They knew that Jesus told them that. They would sit on thrones. Sorry, not on temple. They would sit on thrones and rule in a millennium. So the terms centuries would end about the time Israel became a nation. That would signal. You're not going to count another 100 years from that point onward. Forget it. Because you and I have enough in the book of Revelation and the things that God's revealed, we know there's not another century to go, another 100 years. But we know there would be seasons from 1948. There's been how many seasons since 1948? We're almost at six seasons. 6 decades has gone by, right? So he says, if it's not for them to know the time or the season that the Father's kept in his hand, why would he even say that? Because it's meant somewheres, somebody somewheres, when the time is right and come on ground, they would know the times and they would start to understand where the seasons are starting. So now we're not looking at centuries no more. We're looking at decades. There's more scriptures. Let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Here's the Apostle Paul after Jesus has told him, it's not for you to know the time or the seasons. And just before chapter 5, as you're into chapter 4 in the latter part of it, Paul is given a clue to that early church of some things that should transpire, not in their day, but somewhere in the future, associated with things getting ready for that kingdom to come. Because in chapter 4, verse 15, he says, "For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord." Now Paul's saying this is God's word. And I must repeat, not repeat, but if Paul is saying this is God's word, then to those that was alive in that hour, whether they were true believers or the false ones, there's no place for them to hide. That divides whether people believe the truth or God believes in fables. "For this we say by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them that are asleep." So there's going to be a rapture. Well, that's great, because Jesus also spoke about a rapture. One shall be taken, one shall be left. But he didn't say, they didn't have no idea how long it would be down in time. "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remaining shall be caught up together to meet them in the clouds, and meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Comfort one another with these words." In other words, God has given them hope, saying somewhere there's going to be a rapture. They might have believed they might have been the ones that would be changed in the twinkling of an eye, but it was not going to happen in that first church age. That would be for us. But at least there's hope in the whole picture for them looking at, well, if it doesn't happen in our time, the dead in Christ shall rise first. So there is a resurrection. Then Paul, as he's speaking this to encourage the believers, as the Lord has given that to speak to them, now in chapter 5, verse 1, he says, "But of the times," he's saying the same words as Jesus is saying, "but of the time and the season, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you." He didn't have to write on them because they should have listened what Jesus says. It's not for you to know. As Gentiles, but I want to know. But you ain't going to know. If God says not now, it's not now. But there is going to be a people that will know when and how close they're getting to. All right. Now to bring this all about, we have scripturally wise concerning what Jesus says in Acts chapter 1 verse 7. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1, we have come through the times, which is the centuries or the centuries of time. Because centuries wasn't a word spoken in those days. It's a new word, not for us now. But in the days that Jesus was there, they didn't talk about centuries. They didn't even use the word decades. That only came about when the calendar started to come about. Some 500 years later. I don't know when exactly when they start bringing these terminology of centuries and decades, but it definitely was not in the days of Jesus. Because otherwise he would have said, well, there's going to be centuries and decades. Now that would have blew their mind to the early church. Right? Centuries? But I don't live. If I live 90 years, I can't even live one century. See what I mean? So Jesus used enough of the word for them to understand it's not going to be now, but it's going to be later. All right. Now let's turn to Matthew chapter 24. In Matthew chapter 24, here Jesus is speaking to the disciples while he was on earth. And he says, now learn the parable of a fig tree. He's using an example that they can catch the thought as an illustration. To them it's an illustration. To you and I it's a reality. Now learn of the parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and put forth leaves, ye know summer is nigh. Now in that term, if Jesus could have spoke, he says, these are not times or centuries. This would be in the terms of seasons. Puts forth leaves, summer is nigh. So likewise, when you shall see these things, know that it's near at the doors. It's at the door nearing the end. Not too far from there would be when they would be going into that millennium. But it was not for them to know. Although he spoke some of this so we could have some information to look in between the details when we're looking at the seasons where we are at. I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. A generation is not centuries. A generation, we live in terms of decades. Well, you see, Brother Fred, I seen on the news on Live at 5 here in a TV station, there was a woman that's 116 years old. She's a century. That's just one. The average person is not that way. So the Lord says it, 70 years is the average. All right. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. In other words, Jesus is saying it would be easier for heaven and earth to pass away than God's word to fail. It's not means heaven and earth is going to disappear. Verse 36 is the one I want to get. But of that day and the hour knoweth no man, knoweth not the angels, but my Father in heaven. Now there's in Mark or in 13:32, it talks about that even the Son don't know that day or the hour. Now why would now the Lord say, knowing the day or the hour? And I have to say to the movement today, if you don't know the season, how in the world are you going to know what Jesus is saying about the day and the hour? But I believe there's a group of people on the earth that knows the season even. And the season whether you know it or whether you're not, we're living in that last decade now of time. We're not looking at 2 decades away from here or half a decade. We're looking about in the terms of a decade of time. Well, you say, I don't know that. We'd have to bring in, now, if you're new, there's a lot of backgrounds that the Lord has given us in our understanding in this hour that we can speak in those terms. And I know there's been reluctance and or whatever case may be, but sooner either God's going to confirm it, we're true, or we're false, or they're false, one or the other. But it can't be both ways. Hosea 6 and 2. How that Brother Jackson preached a lot on it. That it's 2 days. Now there it talks about 2 days. But the days in the terms of Hosea, it's a long period of time. Which means 2,000 years. Each day is 1,000 years. So it'll be 2,000 years of time. That when it ends, Israel, God would be dealing with the nation of Israel. And Brother Jackson had every right to look at it at the beginning of the Grace Age from 33 AD onward. But 2004 has passed away. But the revelation that's containing about what he speaks about concerning the events is still dead on. It's just the date's wrong. And if the date is wrong, why is it wrong? It's wrong because from what we see in the hour in 2016, God, after 69 weeks from 445 BC till Jesus came and died on the cross of Calvary, God stopped the clock for the Jews. And people are not catching it. If he stopped the clock for measuring time for the Jews, then those 2 days that spoke about in Hosea has nothing to do with the Jewish realm. It has to do with the Gentiles. And the Gentile, now there too. I know that when the angel of the Lord put those times, the worlds and the time that he gave Brother Branham, they said that the Ephesian Church Age started in 53 AD. He took that from, it's similar to Clark, I think, I forget the name. There's a fellow, a Christian way back had looked at and had pretty well the same dates back then. Clarence Larkin, yes. Okay. So now, but the Ephesian church, as we read it, recorded in actual history, Paul was at that church of Ephesus, and if you look at the church of Ephesus where Paul started to minister to the people that was in Ephesians when at school at Troas, where he was instructing them for over two years. That's from 54 to 56. Its infancy is in maybe in 54, but that church is not ready to be declared a delight till it is completed for that hour. Now some put it anywhere from, if you look at the historians, they put that from 53 to 57. So you have about a 4-year gap between them. I kind of like to take the time where Brother Jackson was looking at it when he mentioned about it concerning that Ephesian church age in 56 AD. But then again, it's only related to what we can have accuracy in history and the time being right in the calendar. All right? So knowing that the 2 days of Hosea has nothing to do with 33 AD, I don't know if I have, yeah, here.
From 33 AD, we know 2004 has gone by. It's history. It can't be that. Some people still want to hang on to 2004 and a half if that there's something about it. They're looking at a date. They don't look at the revelation. So God has caused that to be sifted apart. Then when we come to the Gentile church starting anywhere from 53 to 57, let's say, I'm just using for a point of reference, let's say 56. Those 2 days has to be correlated to something. We can't say, well, Brother Jackson had the wrong date, nobody knows anything anymore. Those 2 days, we'll just leave them out there. God will reveal it. He won't reveal it when the rapture comes. It has to be open now. That's not the time for it to be revealed. And if it's not the Ephesian church age, if it's not the Gentile age of time, which beautifully sits right into the right time frame. If it's not that, we look at 69 AD as being the other important event that you can start looking at those 2 days, or those 2,000 years. A good majority here will not be here. The ministries on ground now will not be here either. So that is another fact showing it has to fall in with that Gentile church age. And when we look at Israel being a nation in one day, that was in 1948. And Brother Branham and Brother Jackson have every right to look at it. From 1948, there would be a generation of time. But when you read that verse, when Jesus is saying, when you see that fig tree put forth a bud, and then it puts forth leaves, then you know summer's nigh. So was he stressing the point of when the bud started, 48? Or in 67 when it starts putting leaves? And if it's 67, you and I are this generation. The ministry and the believers are this generation that is on ground now that fits the picture of that fig tree parable more so than 1948. Because 1948, that was Brother Jackson's ministry, generation. Now, if you're here in a different age or something, I got time, I'm over that. God's looking at a generation as a whole, not individuals. So, aside from, and in order for those 2 days to start, there has to be something important in God's word or history relating to the gospel or relating to what God is doing that you have to start a date from. Otherwise, if you don't have nothing, then you can put that 2 days anywhere. Make it float. And what says? And if you don't have a point of reference, then you're just floating along. Well, somewheres. It's just like the denominational church. Behold, at midnight there came a cry. They have nowhere near getting closer or knowing anything how close they're getting to what the Lord is doing and when He's actually going to come. You talk to the denominational church. Don't talk. I'm not saying for you to talk, but when you talk to them, they have no idea. Well, the Lord's going to come. Yeah, we know. But if Jesus took the trouble, says, of the times and the seasons, back then no man knows, but in this hour, men are going to know. And then He adds on to, how can I put it? Looking at it in this way, He puts it in such a place that you won't know the day or the hour. In other words, He's giving a hint that's showing that it's going to be that close as we get to it. But if you can't recognize a decade that you're living in, you ain't going to recognize that day or that hour. It'll come to you as a surprise. It's best as I can maybe deal with it here this morning. Another parable that we can relate to showing it is a Gentile age of time keep losing it there. There it is. That it has to be that. Otherwise, if you take 69 AD, we ain't going to be the generation. So what else are you going to put in there? Or just deny, say, well, nobody knows what it is. No, you may not know, but there's the people on earth that do know. That's been hearing from God what God has brought in this hour. And the hardest thing for people to see and to believe is the revelation that God brings in their hour, not in hours past. History's hindsight 2020. But God always tests the people that lives in their hour, in their day. So as Israel became a nation in one day, now why am I looking at Jerusalem in 1967? It's about, now I know Brother Branham, his message was, as he started bringing the word in his latter years, it closed the door to the denominational church. But as he passes off the scene, all the denominational church were closed through the revelation of the Word of God by 1967. Goes hand in hand when now God is moving with Israel. And we are living in what's called the fullness of the Gentiles. How long is that fullness of the Gentiles? It's in terms of decades. I'd have to say almost, if you look at 2 decades of time, wrong chart. 2 decades of times from 67 brings you to 2027. Right about here. Now, I'm not looking at this to say it's this year and that date, but we're going to get a closer approximation. We know it's going to happen within the decade we're living now. And this decade that we're living in now, these things is going to be fulfilled in it. And as we get closer, we see the miracle war, the building of the temple, the Ezekiel 38 and 39, then we can get closer and we'll know more than a space of 4 years now, or 3 years, whatever, because if we knew this exactly when it was in the Ephesian church, God was looking at it for His Word, then we would know exactly when it is over here. That would give you the year almost. But we're not here to look at the year, but it's in that close proximity. And when we get near to that point in time, when we see the events on ground taking place, then we're getting to the place where we will be, that sees that decade, we'll know it for sure. And then we'll be looking in the terms of days or weeks. Because then the actual day or the hour, no man will know. God purposely held that even from His Son. The great eternal Spirit has done that. Now I want to look at another parable while we're looking at this. So we are moving along in time, and I want to go to in Luke, the 12th chapter. Been over that scripture a whole lot of times. Verse 36. And ye yourselves liken unto men that wait for their Lord when He will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, that they may open unto him immediately. Now, it's not the wedding takes place in glory. The wedding supper does. He has come in a shout that has been feeding us these last 40 some odd years. We've had that Lord feeding us using that ministry of that apostle, of Brother Jackson. If you want to, it started with Brother Branham when he started preaching the word to that extent. But it is, he is directing this through to the earth. So while they're being fed here, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, finds watching. Some are watching, and some are discouraged or despondent, not watching. Because otherwise he wouldn't even put it in there if everybody was watching. When he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you, he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and shall come and serve them. Now, verse 38, has been hanging out there. And if he shall come in the second watch, and come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. What's the second watch? Where does it fit? What's the third watch? When did the watch begin? In Matthew chapter 25. The watch began in that sixth verse. The first watch. Because he doesn't, in verse 38 in Luke, he doesn't mention the first watch, does he? But all that's transpiring, him delivering meats to the servant, is actually that first watch. But what time is that watch? Is that the watch that begins the day? Or in the middle of the day? Or at the break of dawn? No. Verse 6 says, at midnight there became a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. That's the ministry of Brother Branham. That's that first watch. Because through his ministry, God was really pushing, he is coming. Get ready. Get back to the Word. And that first watch is not at 6 p.m., but that cry came at midnight, right? And it has to do with the Word that we see in Matthew chapter 25. If you overlay that with Luke here, as he's feeding servants, the second watch, what's it mean, watch? Oh, it's this time frame here, and actually looking for a date. It has nothing to do with a date, but the spiritual condition and what's affecting mankind in the bride at that hour. So when he says, at midnight there was a cry made, it's referring to the dark hour of time, isn't it? So when we go back to Luke now, in chapter 38, and if he shall come in the second watch. Well, in the days of Brother Branham, people was watching for the coming of the Lord. Then God tests the movement. He brings an apostle on the scene. And that the Branham movement has lost their way to know how to watch. So now God brings a second watch. Watching, not time frame, because it's after midnight, it's dark, it's late. And now he brings an apostle on the scene, where he brings a revelation on ground that causes you and I to watch even more closely. Be careful and watch. That's the second watch.
It's not related to a time, but to a messages that God is giving to a people for them to watch and wait till He comes. But we're going to read something in here too as well. And in verse 38 says, in the second watch, or in the third watch, and find them blessed are those servants. What is the third watch? It's the word that's coming forth in the fivefold ministry. Because they're blessed because the Lord is coming. You see it? There is no more ministry after the fivefold ministry. The Lord will be here. So the first watch, you can relate that to Matthew chapter 25, verse 6, where at midnight there was a cry made. That's Brother Branham's ministry. God used that servant for people to look for His coming. But then He tests them to see if they're actually watching and waiting to come. And He finds a whole bunch that are not, just playing around, even though they're in Brother Branham's message. And so He brings a second watch. He could have said, I'll bring in another ministry. And so now in the ministry of that apostolic ministry, at the same time that apostle ministry is in that second watch, he's reading between the lines here, he's training that fivefold ministry. He's feeding servants. He's not feeding the garbage man or the mall goer or things like that or people of the world. He's training a ministry. And people are being trained as well as hearing the message as they come along and being acquainted with it. But it too, when Brother Jackson has passed off the scene, God now tests that move. And Brother, I'll put it this way, in the days of Brother Bram, they can only watch in the revelation they have for there, which is not overly clear. In the days of Brother Jackson, God adds more information for the movement to watch into. But now there's this hour. Is history going to repeat itself from the Branham movement to the days of Brother Jackson and the days of the fivefold ministry? The naysayers know. But it don't matter. God is doing something in this hour. God's going to have some voices that are going to speak things. Some say, well, it's just your ideas. If it's just an idea, God will raise up a vessel to bring a revelation and shoot that to pieces. But if nothing can raise up to shoot it to pieces, then it ought to speak something. And just to say it's not and you don't know, then it's best to be quiet about it. Because you could be speaking against God. Don't look at the vessel, look at what God has been bringing. This bride is not going to be put together by men trying to work together in love. It's going to be headship. God has to choose somebody. And the problem in this hour, you don't get to choose who it is. God chooses them. And how does He choose them? By way He speaks. Will identify what God's doing. And not, God's not going to put ahead, well, now I like all kind of, you think you could see this? Can you look at it? No, He's going to speak firm. Like Brother, that video, that small snippet we put a video of Brother Jackson on the internet, on their website. He's going to speak loud enough. And they're not going to care who it hurts or what name it is. Because time is short. God's no longer playing around. That's why in 2016, the shaking has started. It started in the movement. It's in the religious world.
and it's also in the secular world. How long is it going to shake? Till God has His way. Till the fivefold ministry gets in its rightful place. This bride's going nowhere. You can preach lovely sermons, uplifting sermons. And it's good to be made ready, and those sermons are wonderful. Don't discount that in any which way or form. Sometimes we need things for our soul or whatever is needful. That's why there's a fivefold ministry. But to see where we are at, it's not on a salvational aspect. It's on putting on the garment to be made ready in a revelatory manner. It talks about that day. Jesus speaks about I'll just quote it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 4. But ye brethren are not in darkness. Of that day, he didn't say of that decade or that century, that day shall not overtake you as a thief. If we don't know the decade we're living in as we're getting near to the time frame, then I'm afraid to say some will be overtaken and not know and recognize the time. Or they'll recognize the events that Brother Jackson brought forth. I should say the Lord, through Brother Jackson, brought forth. Everybody in this movement, when the miracle war happens, hey, great. The building of the temple. The war of Ezekiel 38 and 39. But if you have no idea or concept of the decade you're living in, then you don't know how long is in between these periods of time till the week of Daniel begin. But showing there's a decade, then there's only so many years that can be fulfilled. When the miracle war takes place, it'll be very short. The putting the temple on the ground and getting that ready and to fulfill the other part of the scripture where they're bringing gifts and so forth to Israel, that's going to take 2 to 3 years. In the rough. And to bring back all the Jews back into the land for the land they conquered. So you ain't going to do that overnight. The Ezekiel war takes place. It too is going to be quick in terms of weeks or whatever God will have. It's going to be short. But when that war is over, till the week of Daniel, if we don't know what the 2 days of Hosea is, you have no clue how long, if it is a year, 6 months, or 10 years in between. So that day does not take you unaware. Am I speaking plain this morning? I am on overtime. I'm sorry, but no, I'm not sorry. I got to stop saying that. Now, I don't want you to listen because I said it, or I say things. Take it to the Lord, let the Holy Spirit show you. And if I'm wrong and false, God will raise up a voice that'll kill the revelation. And if a voice raises up and it's not a true revelation, then God will cause that voice to be shut down. Because we're in an hour, God is starting to put this fivefold ministry to get it to work. And men trying to play, positioning themselves and for things they would like, if you're playing with that, you're on dangerous ground. When Brother Jackson spoke on that in the body of Christ, that was in October, just before he passed away in 2004. At the same time, here in Moncton, there came that prophecy, God warning, don't choose who you want or who you will, because God was going to slap some people's fingers if they try to do that. Why would he bring it right about that same month, at the same time, because things were happening? Voices were trying to. So let God use a vessel of clay. And if we're in a ministry, if we know what our ministry is, let's stay within the scope of our ministry. I know there's a certain leeway that you can, that a ministry can speak in or speak on. But you can't take a pastor to make him an apostle. That does not work. Or an evangelist to be an apostle. That does not work. They all have their place, and they're all important as the apostle would be. You can be revelatory understanding ready in that manner, but if your soul is not made ready, you're going to need that pastor. You're going to need that teacher. Right? Well, I better stop because it's getting worse. Must come with old age. And so this morning, I just want to bring about, why did Jesus tell them? It's talking to the disciple that hour. It's not for you to know the times or even the seasons. Well, shouldn't that speak to you and I? We know the times. We ought to know we're in the seasons. 48, 67. Apostle ministry, prophetic ministry, Brother Branham. Apostle ministry, now the fivefold. Maybe I said enough this morning. And I have to say, those that are listening, if you don't like this, don't hook on, please. It's not for the world or any believer that wants to go any which way or just... If you're looking for something to define, I might have said something that could be wrong. I was listening to one of Brother Jackson's message. He was talking about Matthew chapter 25 concerning the sheep and the goats. And I know that's what he was talking about. But he says in Matthew chapter 26. Well, that don't change them. It's the message that count. He might have quoted the wrong scripture. Does that dim? I wouldn't even have a second thought looking at that being wrong. See what I mean? All right, let's just stand this time. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again. Lord, I just pray you use the words that you see fit. Lord, we thank you for truth in this hour. Now, Lord, as we look unto thee, I just pray, Lord, that you have your way. In Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. For the glory belongs to thee. Have the musicians to come. If someone has a need, you can be seated for just a moment and
Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
God bless you.